some of our students, or we ask the teachers to nominate students, and then we pick from that pool. And we had a fifth grade team play the teachers, and then we had a sixth grade team play the teachers, and then the winners played each other. So, and it was probably the loudest that building's ever been. It's crazy, but it was a lot of fun. And as far as that's what we've done so far, and I'm pretty sure Ms. Coffey has big plans for the rest of the year.
The health team has lots of good ideas.
The next piece is technology. I've presented as part of the one-to-one pilots. I'm a one-to-one pilot teacher. We are IT teachers. And so I just kind of wanted to elaborate how it's going at Bernadine 6. We now have 2 sixth grade classrooms that have the one-to-one pilot. They're currently piloting a brand new, not even spoken of, program that's going well. And so we're just taking notes of how that's going to affect the teaching the fifth grade teachers how to get it next year. And, you know, we're just continuing to practice on apps before we give professional development on it. We want to be well-versed before we tell the whole teacher body, hey, this is wonderful and amazing. So my sixth graders are doing awesome. They teach me new things every single day. I feel like sometimes I don't even teach them new things, other than just giving them the resource to do it. And so with that, I'm here with our library and media specialist this year, and we decided to take it to a next level.
So I worked with our guidance counselor, Ms. Kittimer, and we kind of used the guidance from Ms. Anderson, the library media specialist at Charles Stones, and I've been going through the Nearpod app, which is a pretty cool app. You can set up slideshows on it, and all the kids can see what you can see on their home screen, and it has some interactive elements to it as well, and it's been centered around digital citizenship. It's a pretty heavy piece of equipment that we're entrusting to our kids, I think, and I think it's important that we're showing them, modeling for them how responsible they need to be with it, and just how to be ethical when they use it. Some of the topics we've covered, keywords, the keywords, a lot of times sixth grade students like to type in an entire question on Google when they're researching, so we've kind of broken down how that's not really the best avenue to take. How to be a good digital citizen online. There is a person on the other side of your screen when you are talking to them, and how to react and handle when you come in contact with mean and scary language online, just some different resources for them as well. And so it's going pretty well. I'm able to do it with every single class at Bernadine Sits. I see fifth grade 1 week and sixth grade the next week. Like I said, I've been working closely with Ms. Kinnemer, our guidance counselor, and we can track how the students are doing on the lessons. It's pretty easy, and it has an interactive quiz piece once you get to the end of the lesson to see whether or not the students respond well and understand what they learned. So.
Lastly, we're prepping and getting ready for the one-to-one iPad initiative for fifth graders next year. So in addition to the meetings that they're going to monthly with Lee and Casey, we have implemented in our own staff meetings a little training session each and every time that is different from the topics that are going to be covered district-wide. And this is just to help us become more familiar with it, to not make it things so scary, and for all of us to be on the other side of the island together before we hand out these devices to kids. And that goes back up to the digital citizenship, just preparing them before they even have these devices in their hands, how we can interact with the world, and how they can be very valuable resources if we use them appropriately. We also had an addition of lots of clubs and extracurricular activities this year. Big Brothers, Big Sisters, we are the largest enrollment in the 4 schools that have the Big Brothers, Big Sisters program. There's 109 students that are signed up. About 80 attend on a daily basis, though. They've also paired up with Play 60 and Mr. Watkins. And recently they just hosted a family dinner night where they invited the parents of the kids that go to Big Brothers Big Sisters after school to come, and they were served a dinner to kind of get that community piece in and just keep supporting our Big Brothers Big Sisters record.
Choir. last semester we went and we performed at the nursing home on 3rd Street. The kids actually came to me and asked if we could. And I was surprised because a lot of kids don't like to do really nice things like that. And they just wanted to give them a little snippet of holiday love. So we performed there on a Saturday, and the kids asked if we could perform at the other nursing homes before our concert this season. And I said yes. So it's just students who want to go above and beyond to do that. I just think that's very impressive. And for me not to prompt it as well is just outstanding. So we have great students.
You have already seen some of my amazing student 5th grade and 6th grade leaders. They've been very busy participating in monthly events. They did a Socktober event, which collected over 500 socks that were donated locally. Women's socks were donated to the women, the ABC Pregnancy Center, and the men's socks were donated to the GC3 closet, which gives people on the campus accessibility. They did Red Ribbon Week this week, Pause, Don't Touch Drugs. Day of the Dead, there's a William Allen White book this year that relates to the Day of the Dead, and so they planned activities for each and every classroom to make Day of the Dead masks, and then teachers read the William Allen White book, and then students were able to take the test for that month. So every single student had access to do that, so there was a huge literary element to that. They did a Be Seen, Be Safe awareness where they sold glow sticks on Halloween all day. So students could have glow sticks before they go into the trick-or-treating into the community. In November, they did a canned food drive to the Emmaus House. I think you'll see one of our students packing up all of our, I think we had 4,000 ounces of food donated this year, which was double what we had done last year. And then we did a Christmas Around the World. Students prepared boards from 10 different countries. And while they went to go visit Ms. Watson in the library for their 5th or 6th grade week, we're able to go around in the boards, learn a little bit about another culture's celebrations of their holidays. And then there were little things that they could take, whether it's a crossword or something that could help them remember what they learned. So the students totally prepped that all on their own. And then last is they are going to be teaming up with a family engagement team to do the reading week for the first Friday.
Drama Club. In the fall, we did one play. It was a zombie play for December, which is a little weird, but the students really enjoyed it. It was called 10 Ways to Survive a Zombie Apocalypse. Ms. Souza was actually in it as well, so we got staff to participate, which was really fun. And then this semester, we are breaking it up into quarters, because the students want to do more. They want to become more involved instead of just work on one thing. So this quarter, the students are writing their own plays. They are taking the initiative and preparing the drama club themselves, which is awesome. They get to create the story, the characters, the plot, everything. So, and that performance is going to be, I think, March 20th, which I think should be a Monday. And then the next quarter, we're doing So You Want to Be a Cheerleader. And once again, the drama students actually asked if we could perform this for the nursing homes too. And I was like, that's a lot. We'll see. We'll see how well we can do. So, yeah, we have a lot of stuff going on with the drama club. And we have done a lot of fundraising for the drama club as well. So the more fundraising, the better for costumes.
I'm a co-sponsor with Deanne Graham. She's a 6th grade math teacher in our building for the school bank, and we are in a partnership with First National Bank. One of our feeder schools, Edith Sherman, always send to us lots of students that have developed bank accounts in their elementary school. So we work with them to keep adding to their savings each week when they come to us. We have 6th grade students apply to be workers in the fall, and they get to be tellers, customer service, marketing, different things like that, and we just started a new round, so we have all new bank employees this year. We do weekly prizes and giveaways to kind of drum up some more participation. It's a really good program. It teaches the kids a lot about saving, because you can talk to them about maybe
want a car someday. If you start saving now as a fifth and sixth grader, that money's going to be there until you need it. So it's just a really good program that we have started and that we continue to do at our school.
All righty. So these are some of the amazing things going on. I know we went well over our time, but it's very hard to crunch all of the great things going on in my building with just a little snippet. So I hope you guys enjoyed, and please feel free to visit anytime. We love having community members in our building, so please come in. Come and join us whenever we run our April 5K and 1 mile fun run. Make sure you guys come and get your fitness on with us. Thank you, guys.
And come to Freddy's tomorrow night.
There you go.
It's Freddy. Our Freddy's night fundraiser.
There you go.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Amber Potts. I teach 7th grade science at Horace Cook Middle School, and I'm also the site coordinator for the AVID program at the middle for Horace Cook.
And I'm Andy Potts. I teach 7th grade science at Kenneth Henderson, and I'm our building coordinator for AVID as well.
And I'm Jacob Huth. I teach facts and also the AVID elective at Kenneth Henderson.
So we're here tonight just to kind of give an update on AVID at the middle level, how it's going. So we kind of recognize that AVID would be a great program to start implementing at the middle level, just with our student population, as well as helping to further promote it at the high school level. And so we were presented about this time last year with Live Well Finney County Health Coalition, a grant through them, and we applied, or I didn't apply, but somebody applied for the grant, and we found out late last summer that we were accepted, and so we kind of proceeded from there, and so far the grant has paid, or helped to pay for the staff training through the AVID.
So with our funding secured, we had some challenges to overcome to get the program implemented, considering that the enrollment for that year had already passed, had already closed, and students had already chosen classes. We kind of rushed really quickly to identify our AVID elective teachers. We worked with counselors to help identify the students that would benefit best from being a part of the AVID program. And then we got 8 staff in each building, including admin, counselors, and content area teachers, sent to an AVID training to be trained in some sort of approach to the AVID program.
So at Horace Good, we currently have one section combined 7th to 8th grade students with totaling 16 students. We started out last semester after that scramble to get students enrolled. We just kind of opened it to 8th graders, and we started with a small section of 8th graders. At semester, we were able to spark interest in 7th graders, and so we just were able to make that one combined 7th, 8th grade class at Horace Good.
At Kenneth Henderson, we have one section with a total of 8 students, all at the 8th grade level. We're hopeful that next year we could add a second section for 7th grade or do a mixed group. But in terms of the middle school elective, it mirrors what we see at the high school in terms of some best practice strategies, reading, writing, collaboration, organization. introduces students to things that they're going to see at the high school level and really familiarizes them with that so that they're, when they move on to high school, they're better prepared. And it's been fairly successful given our complete rollout of it.
And then lastly, just in terms of our future planning, we kind of recognize that the numbers are a little low. We started kind of in a rush, if you will. And so we kind of, both buildings focus on kind of three big ways to increasing our numbers. So one being we are in time for enrollment this year. So really plugging in with the sixth graders when we go visit them with them for enrollment. And to continue with seventh grade, transitioning them into it in their eighth grade year. And then those eighth graders, really helping them transition it, keep it at the high school level. Second, we are going to, each building will select one or two AVID instructional strategies as a building and train staff and fully implement those strategies picked at each building for our next school year. So every teacher will be implementing in their classroom at least one or two of those AVID instructional strategies. And then we also have the AVID Summer Institute, which is taking place, I believe, in June in Denver. And I believe Jenny Hands has already kind of started the process of getting people enrolled and securing spots for that. Those are kind of our three, where we're going.
I can just jump in a minute. These three were the initial middle school guinea pigs, so to speak. We found out we got the grant and said, can you please go to Summer Institute so we can at least kick something off in the fall? And then we weren't able to train the rest of each of the staffs until the fall. And so they dove in like crazy to figure it out, and then they didn't give themselves enough credit, but they lead a lot of professional development in their own buildings on AVID strategies and what it really means. Because the goal with Finney County LiveWell is to get these strategies into everyone's hands, not just students in the AVID electives, but they're good teaching and learning strategies. But teachers often feel overwhelmed, so it's how can you take what you're currently doing and implement the right strategies to make and support AVID school-wide. So they have done a really good job, and I have no doubt they're going to double their enrollment for next year. I just don't. Kids are getting the hang of it. They see the effectiveness. They're seeing success in their classes, so they're doing a nice job.
Can you give us, or remind us, because I know we've had AVID present to us before, some of the instructional strategies that you're talking about?
The acronym is called WICR, and I mentioned it briefly before, but there are very many things that are based in writing, reading, collaboration, organization. Maybe you've heard or seen students demonstrate the binder. That is a big part of it. We're essentially teaching college skills, and so there's a gigantic binder that goes along with it. There's also a tutorial process where we've had college tutors that come in and work with the students. And so we really work on that collaboration piece and building what we call relational capacity, their ability of them to solve problems using a group. So that's been something that we've had a lot of success with, even in these very early stages.
Further questions?
I do have a comment. I really love AVID. I have a student who's a sophomore in college now and went through 4 years of AVID at the high school, and I know that that's why he's a sophomore in college now. And I have an eighth grader who was not organized in any other portion of his life, but is now organized at least somewhat academically. AVID is a wonderful program, and I would really like to see it expanded to as many students as possible, because this is one program that's going to combine both the academic skills that they need with the soft skills that employers need. And we don't explicitly teach that anywhere else in our curriculum. From preschool on up, they're just expected to kind of absorb it somewhere. But But in Avid, they do teach that, and it's amazing because a lot of these students, they don't see it anywhere else in their school or growing up. Maybe their family is not organized in that same fashion, but these are skills that will really, really help them as they go forward. So I really appreciate what you're doing. I really appreciate that you jumped in despite the fact that kids were already enrolled in other classes and had to get pulled out of maybe something they thought they liked to be able to be in Avid. But it's a wonderful program, and I really encourage everybody to be very supportive of it. I just was wondering, I know a lot of the high school students that have kind of been doing it for a while, they're very enthusiastic about it. If they would be willing to come and talk to some of these middle school students about how, what the opportunities are and how great it is and how much it'll help you in the rest of your classes, because a lot of times kids see, or they take it a little better from peers or people they admire than they do from teachers or their parents. So, but I really like it. Thank you all for getting that grant and doing it. I hope we can continue that and expand it.
Great job. Thank you for the time. Mm-hmm. Okay. New business, walking trail, burning tips, Don or anything like that?
This is something the city's doing in their effort to make the community more chances to walk and stuff. So the walking trail is going from campus to 3rd Street, and it's going to show you on the drawing there. But there's the ditch, I think you would call it there, right to the south of Bernadine Set, is where the walking trail is going to go. Okay, so this is it. This is the south side of the property here, and this is where the trail is going to be. So it's on the farthest south end of the property. So they're wanting an easement, approximately 55 foot easement, just so when they're building it, they can come and get on our property and use it, and then any maintenance they'd have to do after that, they'd have access to it. But it's not going to affect it at all. This is a retaining pond for our property, so it catches all the water off the parking lot, and it comes down and they're holding to this area right here. So it won't be affected at all. They're just asking for to have this piece for an easement, for there to have access to it. So
where's the ditch on that?
It's on this side. It's right here. There's the alley here for the homeowners over here.
Okay.
And then the drainage ditch right there.
Okay.
So the walking trail is on top of the north side of the drainage ditch.
Is it going to be as wide as the Tally Trail?
I think so. 10 foot, I think, is what it's slated for, I believe. 10 or 12, but it's going to be a good trail.
This seems like something where it would maybe encourage kids to walk to school.
Definitely,
or ride bikes to school.
Yeah.
That otherwise wouldn't have as easy an access.
Definitely. And I've been out there walking around it, and with as dry as it is, dust flying everywhere. So it'd be really nice for the community to use it.
Sure. What will it be surfaced to?
I'm sorry?
What will they surface it?
Asphalt. Yeah, it'd be just like the Tally Trail, the existing trail there. But it's a good thing for the city. It just ties all the trails together a lot easier. Right now. And then the sidewalk that was put in on 3rd Street there along the cemetery. It'll connect it back so you can get up to the Tally Trail that way, I think. Cut through that other trail that's between Mary and just to the south of Mary Street there, between 8th and there's another trail that's set up over there. I don't know the name of it for sure. sure, but it'll tie the community all together for you.
Any question? Is this costing us anything?
No, we're going to make a dollar off of it.
Dollars a dollar.
Dollars a dollar.
We'll make sure that that's good use.
Yeah. So the easement, how explains to me how long the easement is.
It goes for the whole property.
Oh, right.
Yeah, from this is Belmont Street over here. And then, so then the church land is over this way. So it's the whole thing there. Like I say, it 55 foot comes from the edge of the trail. It would go right to the edge of the trees. But I didn't know if they were measuring from the center of the trail, which would be the bottom of the upside of the ditch. So, but it won't affect anything. The trees that we have there right now and the retention pond, it's just a holding tank, basically.
So they don't have any problems with paving over the retention pond?
No, it's actually on the top side of the south side of the retention pond. So it won't affect the existing retention pond at all.
And how long does the easement last?
Forever.
Right.
Yeah.
But with the retention pond there would never be any likelihood that we would be able to use that part of the lot for any purpose.
It just keeps us the sole owner of the retention ditch, so they can't come in and do something with it later on. So it allows us to keep it for our use, what it's designed for right now.
I guess what I'm getting at is it's never going to restrict our ability to make any modifications to parking lots, to building structures, or anything like that.
I don't think so.
With the retention pond, they're never going to let us go that direction anyway.
No. Right? Yeah. Yeah. We wouldn't need to. We've got all this over here that we could use if needed.
Okay.
For sure. And then the back side is a parking lot up there too.
Okay. And it won't interfere with any of our existing landscaping. And as John said, we're not using that for anything but that.
Further questions? How soon do they start on that?
They're going to bid it in September of 18, and then it'll probably be in 19 when they get started on it, more than likely.
Okay. Do we have anything on that?
This is the first time you've heard about it, so we aren't asking you to do anything tonight. We'll really to bring it back next time, or we'll put it on the consent agenda.
Do you have a question?
How well the district has been working with other groups, the city, the YMCA for the Dome Project. I mean, there's other things too, and I think that's a really good thing that we're involved in the community and working with other agencies and different groups to improve life in Lorraine City, because that kind of a walking trail is going to be great for the kids there, because earlier presentation, a lot of the activities that we're trying to get them involved with involve exercise, and it's great for the community to have a pretty long path. And I don't know how long that'll make the walking trail, but it's going to be pretty extensive.
Yeah.
They can go all the way up there. So
it's a good thing. We do a lot. We do work with the city on lots of things, the little things that we have to work with each other on. So it's a good relationship.
Yeah.
I've heard horror stories from other districts and other areas.
Good job.
Yeah.
Other comments?
All right. Thank you, John.
All right. Thanks. Thanks, DJ.
Thanks,
Todd.
So we're at agenda item H, board open discussion. Jane, we'll start with you. Do you have anything?
I did, and I meant to bring this up before, but on December 8th, Horace Good had they talked about how anxious kids are at that age and how sometimes they don't feel like they have any options. And so one of the things, the strategies that they, the counselors brought up was they gave all these kids these little cards. And the idea behind these cards, and I was going to pass these out, is that you would carry the card around with you, but if you really got to the point where you just couldn't verbalize what your problem was, you could give this card to somebody if you were at that point, and they would be able to take this and read the back of it and help you so that it wouldn't you wouldn't get to that point where you felt suicide was the only option. It was a really good program. It's called the Yellow Ribbon Program, and I have more of these cards, but I just thought that was a really good option. Most of the kids, I went and walked the aisle to see if they were any on the floor, and there were only a couple. So most of the kids did take those, and I think sometimes it is hard for students at any level or anyone really to just tell somebody how desperate they're feeling, and so I thought these cards were a really good idea, and I appreciate the counselor being trained in this program and bringing it to our school. I think it will really help. So, more cards if anybody would like to have them, pass them out to people they know.
Very good. Thank you. Jennifer?
I'm with you.
Okay, you know? Dana? Okay.
I guess we're going to have an early night tonight.
I haven't gotten to meet yet. I got a list.
Put the pressure on you.
I got a list. So my turn. So as I keep driving by KH, I see that we're doing the construction for the bus driveway, right? I don't see any action at the dome. Is that the way it's supposed to be?
I think so. I think they'll do the majority of the concrete work first. And the dome, I'm not sure what the, do you know John? John gets to go to all those construction meetings.
Yeah, so they're doing all the dirt work now for all the concrete. Now the next step will be the footings for the dome, and then we'll start the parking lot and the bus lane and start all the concrete project now. So then after the concrete floor is poured for the building, we have to wait 28 days for it to cure, and then the tent should arrive for the building, or the fabric should arrive for the dome at that time. And then,
okay, it just seemed like there was a lot of dirt moving on and didn't see anything else going on. Okay,
yeah.
Very good. At the city commission, maybe a couple of weeks ago, somebody talked about safe zones and asking the city if they would develop these safe zones where people could go drop off. You know, if you needed to meet someone or, you know, to drop off a kid because a couple of divorced or something, that they're just safe places where people can go do something. And I thought that was a pretty cool idea. I was wondering if the school district can participate in that. I mean, we have a lot of schools that are open, especially the high school. There's always something going on there. I don't know if the city's contacted you about that or if we would be willing to do something like that or... I thought that's pretty. The guy that brought it up talked about that where he was from, that they had them all over the cities. And I'd never heard of them. I didn't know what they were talking about. But as I read the article, I thought, you know, that might be a really good thing for Garden City to have. Because there's things going on all the time. People are buying things on Craigslist and, you know, come pick it up at so and so's house. But you don't even know if that's a safe place or not. Hopefully the city can, I mean the school can help participate and maybe have safe zones to the school. Maybe not, but somebody talked from that out about.
What's in the
paper
this past week?
I just read, it was at the last city commission meeting. So, and then the last thing, I brought a little flyer, Alton Brown selling tickets for a truck. And when I went to the school, I saw the truck. I said, man, that is pretty cool. So one ticket for $20, three for $50. It helps support Alton Brown Elementary School, the business
donated the truck, and parents of the school donated to have it remodeled or reworked, whatever you do to a vehicle. But a really nice vehicle and a real good cause to, you know, support the school besides going to eat at Freddy's and pizza and so forth. So eat healthy, buy a truck. So those are the only things that I got. So with nothing else before us, let's see, Mark had to be out of town, and so did Laura, so we missed both of them. And we'll be back at our next meeting, which is scheduled on Monday, February 19th at 6 p.m. here at the Education Support Center. And if there's nothing before us, entertain a motion to adjourn. Second, moved by Dana, second by James to adjourn the meeting.